What's going on, everyone? Dustin Stelzer with Electrician U. I got to go on a trip recently to Massachusetts and got to hang out with my crew. So I have like a team here in Austin, but I also have a team over in Massachusetts. So we were doing like a big creative meeting kind of thing. So we got a lot of like really cool stuff that we're trying to make happen. But while I was there, I thought it'd be a really good idea because the whole area is really, really old. To go through some of the old like paper mills and like really just old buildings that had, you know, stuff wired from like the early 1900s. So the building that we went to, I think, was built in like 1905, somewhere around there. Just really, really old. So we're talking about pre-National Electric Code. A lot of just like weird things that you'll see, but there's also new things that were installed in the space that were done not to code. So walking through a building like this, you're seeing all kinds of stuff that is not at all to code. You see some stuff that's installed to code, you know, but a lot of this, they're dealing with structures and buildings and things that weren't really built in a way that it's not friendly with modern codes. So a lot of the wiring, you can just tell, they're just kind of trying to do whatever they can in the safest way they can to make things work. But I wanted to go over a few of the things that I saw that were just, I don't know, kind of crazy. So the first thing that I came across when I was walking up were these two meter cans, and they were wired in a way so that the conduit was run right in front of a window. So, you know, these windows may not open, who really knows, they're like 100-year-old windows, but I just thought it was kind of crazy that they, instead of like running the conduit under one of the other 90s and going up together in a corner, they just went like right in front of a window, and then the entire thing's not even strapped. So they did strap within 30 inches, you know, right where the 90 comes up, but then there's just no other strapping. It goes up, 90's over, and goes through a wall somewhere. 358.30, securing and supporting EMT shall be installed as a complete system in accordance with 300.18 and shall be securely fastened in place and supported in accordance with 358.30 A and B. So A is securely fastened. EMT shall be securely fastened in place at intervals not exceeding 10 feet. In addition, each EMT run between termination points shall be securely fastened within 3 feet of each outlet box, junction box, device box, cabinet, conduit body, or other tubing termination. And then B supports, it says horizontal runs of EMT supports by openings through framing members shall not be more than 10 feet and securely fastened within 3 feet of termination points. So that doesn't really deal with the situation. It's more in that vertical run. We don't have any kind of strapping and it goes more than 10 feet. Granted, they're in front of a window, but again, if they wouldn't have gone in front of the window and would have gone over the corner to the brick, they could have actually secured this stuff, strapped it to code. The other thing to take note of is none of the fittings are rain tight fittings. All of them are set screw fittings, so they're not installed to code. So right underneath that, it says 358.42, couplings and connectors. Couplings and connectors used with EMT shall be made up tight. Where buried in masonry or concrete, they shall be concrete type. And where installed in wet locations, outside definitely is, they shall comply with 314.15. If we flip over there really quick, 314.15, damp and wet locations. In damp or wet locations, boxes, conduit bodies, outlet box hoods, and fittings shall be placed or equipped so as to prevent moisture from entering or accumulating within a box, conduit body, or fitting. Boxes, conduit bodies, outlet box hoods, and fittings installed in wet locations shall be listed for use in wet locations. So that was obviously not to code. So I just thought that was like, when I'm going through any kind of place, I'm always looking at all the electrical stuff. You do service work for a long enough time, and you're just kind of like always going around to see if you can find some craziness. So this was fun for me. This was actually like, I'm not crapping on any electricians in the area or calling anybody bad. It's just cool to go through all these old things because I just knew it was gonna be fraught with all kinds of craziness. The next thing that I came across was this weird light fixture setup. So there was an existing light fixture over a door, and then they put these little LBs mounted upside down with a little piece of pipe in between them, and then installed what looks like a barn light that's supposed to be hung with the light down, was actually flipped up which I don't know, maybe it's allowed, maybe it's listed to be installed upside down, but to me it looked upside down. And the way that they mounted it, you know, at least they put like a gasket behind it, they mounted it to something so that moisture can't get in. I highly doubt there's a box behind it. So that really doesn't matter. It's really just screwed, I think, right into the brick. The thing that I took note of was like kind of like the weird fittings and the way in which they did it. So they didn't just run conduit in between it, or they didn't just take one light off and put a different light on that has a motion sensor on it. Like this fixture definitely has a motion sensor on it, and I think that's the functionality that they were looking for, and that's why they added it this way. So my guess is that they were trying to make sure they had an egress light that would work if power failure was happening, although I don't see like a battery pack anywhere. I just thought that was kind of crazy. It just looked like a really weird thing. The one thing that I did take note of is they used rain tight fittings on everything. So they actually have all of the EMT fittings that are rain tight, and you can tell with the little yellow gasket. And I didn't know this until now. I had never used one before, but for offset nipples, like the one that's under the fixture on the left, it's a nipple, but they make kind of this weird offset shape so that you can, if you don't have a nipple that lines up, you have a little bit of flexibility to kind of rotate this to get out. But they actually make those in rain tight. I've just never used one. I try not to use these things if I don't have to, but I learned that they actually do have them that are rain tight rated, and this one is. And then as I walked around the corner in this big alleyway, I saw what looked like a huge water pipe. It was like probably a 4-inch pipe, looked like galvanized. It actually looked like rigid up to a certain point because there was a rigid coupling. And then it seemed like it changed over to like black pipe, maybe. It still seemed galvanized, but it had bolted together flanges like you would see on an exhaust system or like, you know, plumbing or something like that. So I was just like, what the heck? And I kept following it over, and it dumped down 90'd into an actual junction box. And it was bolted to the top of this junction box. And I was like, what is that? I've never seen that. So maybe that was just a method back in the day that they did this, or maybe they were just hacking some stuff together. I just have never seen that before. The next thing that I noticed, and this isn't something I noticed because there was a problem. I noticed this because this is a conversation that I had recently. But air conditioning disconnects, right? Sometimes different parts of the country, you'll see ACs on the exterior of like buildings that are multiple stories tall, and you've got these ACs out there and disconnects mounted next to them. And people are like, well, wait, don't you have to be able to readily access a disconnecting means for anybody that might have to do maintenance or anything like that? So like, shouldn't all the disconnects be down low where they're accessible? And I thought that was a really good question. So in this case, we have all of these air conditioning units. These are all mini splits, but there's still the compressor unit outside, and then there's probably some indoor unit on a wall somewhere in a specific office. And down this alleyway, there was tons of these units all mounted on the wall at the same height, which was probably about 12 feet off the ground. So all of the disconnects were mounted 12 feet off the ground right next to the units. So is that a code violation? 440 part 2 is where we start talking about disconnecting means, specifically 440.14 for disconnecting means for air conditioning and refrigeration equipment. It says location, disconnecting means shall be located within sight from and readily accessible from the air conditioning or refrigeration equipment. The disconnecting means shall be permitted to be installed on or within the air conditioning or refrigeration equipment. That doesn't say that they have to be readily accessible from the ground, or just blanket statement readily accessible. It specifically says they shall be located within sight from and readily accessible from the air conditioning equipment. So to me, that is 80 feet off the ground. As long as somebody can get to that equipment, that's, you know, up to them to do. But this disconnect has to be readily accessible from that equipment. It can be installed on the equipment, in the equipment, right next to the equipment, as long as it is readily accessible. The next thing that I thought was kind of crazy is we were inside the building and we came across these receptacles that were mounted. Now the boxes were mounted and they were using rigid conduit to support the receptacles. Now, that's typically okay, but when you walk up to these things, you can actually just twist it and grab everything. It's not secured very well. So some people would argue, well, in code, you can use, you know, certain types of raceways like rigid to support receptacle boxes. So let's look and see what that says. 314.23F. Raceway supported enclosures with devices, luminaires, or lamp holders. It says an enclosure that contains a device or devices other than splicing devices or supports a luminaire or luminaires, a lamp holder, or other equipment and is supported by entering raceways shall not exceed 100 cubic inches in size. It shall have threaded entries or identified hubs. It shall be supported by two or more conduits, threaded, wrench tight, into the enclosure or hubs. Each conduit shall be secured within 18 inches of the enclosure. So you can use rigid conduit to support a receptacle, but you need to have two conduits that are supporting it, and it needs to be within 18 inches of the enclosure. It needs to be secured. There are some exceptions for that, but they specifically deal with like conduit bodies or luminaires wiring. This is more for a receptacle specifically. And then right next to this, we see a 250 volt, 30 amp receptacle installed right underneath a hose bib. So is that okay? Well, no, that's gonna be considered a wet environment. Location, wet. Installations underground or in concrete slabs or masonry in direct contact with the earth. In location, subject to saturation with water or other liquids, such as vehicle washing areas, and in unprotected locations exposed to weather. So this would definitely, if the water was ever turned on, become completely saturated. Now, in an old building like this, I'm sure over 100 years, those pipes are probably capped off somewhere, cut, they're not even in existence. Somebody probably just left the hose bib there. But I thought it was really interesting. Drake actually is the one that noticed that. He's like, whoa, whoa, whoa. And he used to be an apprentice before. So Drake, good job. Then the last thing that I noticed everywhere, which is kind of an interesting issue to even try to find a code reference for, was all of these junction boxes throughout the entire building. There were tons of them, with just no covers. So it's like every hallway, every room I walked into, there were just boxes wide open, conductors hanging out of them. So I don't know if they're capped off. I don't know if they're dead. I don't know if they're live.
Comes out of the J box on the right. Does some twisty craziness. And goes to the one on the left. Just hanging, just chilling.
And this is everywhere throughout the building. So within this building, it's also important to note, there are people walking around everywhere because there are actually new businesses being built within this building. So they're kind of like subdividing the floors into actual businesses and putting hallways and doors and everything. So there's tons of people walking in and out of these things just freely. And there's no areas that are like barricaded off that you can't go into, or if they are, they're like owned by somebody that's like their art studio or something like that. But the actual wires that you could come in contact with. I wish I had a multimeter when I was there to check, but there were just wires hanging out of boxes everywhere. So what does code say about that? Not much specifically. So if we go into 314.28C, it says covers. All pull boxes, junction boxes, and conduit bodies shall be provided with covers. Provided with, not enclosed, not sealed, not installed, shall be provided with covers compatible with the box or conduit body construction and suitable for the conditions of use. Where used, metal covers shall comply with the grounding requirements of 250.110. So it doesn't really say the installation of the cover needs to be an enclosed cover, but if we do look forward in the 1000 volt section, so we're in part four, pull and junction boxes, conduit bodies, over 1000 volts, it has a little bit different language. So it actually says 314.72C, complete enclosures. Boxes shall provide a complete enclosure for the contained conductors or cables. And then under E, it says suitable covers. Boxes shall be closed by suitable covers securely fastened in place. So that actually does specifically say the boxes need to be enclosed and secured. But it's a little bit more specific. So that code actually says they shall be closed by suitable covers. And I just found it interesting that in 314.28, nowhere in there does it say anything about them having to be closed. Now there is OSHA. OSHA also mentions a very similar kind of thing. So in OSHA 1910.305, we've got B21. It says all pull boxes, junction boxes, and fittings shall be provided with covers, provided with, again, identified for the purpose. If metal covers are used, they shall be grounded in complete installations. Each outlet box shall have a cover, faceplate, or fixture canopy. Covers of outlet boxes having holes through which flexible cord pendants pass through shall be provided with bushings designed for the purpose and shall have smooth, well-rounded surfaces on which the cords may bear. And then we have the over 600 volt section again. So we've got, this is OSHA 1910.305B3, pull and junction boxes for systems over 600 volts nominal. It says, in addition to other requirements in this section, the following requirements apply to pull and junction boxes for systems at 600 volts nominal. 1910.305B3I or B31, I suppose. Boxes shall provide a complete enclosure for the contained conductors or cables. And then B32 says boxes shall be closed by suitable covers securely fastened in place. So I find it both in code and in OSHA, they make a point of making sure that anything that is over 600 volts is closed. They use that language specifically, but anything less than the 600 volts, they just say it needs to be provided with one. Well, if you provided it and then somebody took it off and threw it like a fucking Frisbee, it was provided, but it's not closed. So I just found that funny. Now, maybe there is some like weird obscure thing that one of you code gurus out there know about that I've missed in that, that definitely dons it. But if you look anything in raceways, if you look at anything in conduits, junction bodies, there's nothing that I have found so far that demands that it be closed. So if I'm wrong, please teach me and leave some comments in the comments below. I'm sure you already are. But also make sure you're citing your sources. At least here, I'm citing my arguments. I'm going through what the code says, and that way I'm getting to my interpretations. It's always important as you go through your career, you're never gonna know all this stuff. Unless you're like helping write code, then you might know a lot of it. But you're, most electricians are never gonna know everything. So when you're having a conversation with somebody, it's the only way to have intellectual discourse about a topic is to have at least what you have found, because it shows that you've done your research and that you're seeking and that you're not just out there spouting off shit from a Facebook page somewhere. So always go into these conversations where you're trying to talk about code by citing code, and people will actually listen to you and respect your opinion. Otherwise, you're just kind of popping off. So thank you guys so much. That was it. It was a really, really cool trip. Got to walk through all these old buildings. There's tons of stuff over there in Massachusetts. Please make sure you like this video if you liked the video. Also, please subscribe. It super helps me out. I hope that I have earned your subscription. I do this for a living. So thank you guys so much for all of you that do support me. Make sure you hit the little notification bell too. Let you know every time I have a new episode out. And join the Discord server and the Facebook group. Either one of them or both of them doesn't really matter. Some people are more like Facebook-y, some people are more Discord-y, but it's thousands of electricians that sit and talk about stuff like this, code and tools and show pictures and kind of just BS. It's a really good group of people. And if you guys are looking to meet people and gain more friends and be in kind of like a really constructive, awesome learning environment, Discord and Facebook is where it's at. Love you crazy people, and I will see you in the next episode.
Descant music and video.